I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to talk my business talk here in collaboration with Transzone, who happens to be the station chair, and also Dan, the city here. So today I'm going to talk about some extreme scattering amplitudes and its high energy limit. And so the reason why I'm interested in the high energy limit is that in the high energy regime there are some symmetry which is maybe not so manifest in the low energy regime can be more apparent in the high energy limit. One big example from the field theory is known to be the boson equivalent theorem. This theorem said that if you consider the some amplitude with emission of the some longitudinal mode of the massive vector boson, it's equal to the emission of the some Boltzmann bosons in the leading order of the energy high energy expansions. So of course, this fact reflects the some asymmetry behind that the spontaneously growing asymmetry theories, and actually. We can also discuss further, for example, if you impose a three-level unitarity condition in the high energy regime, some consistency condition, then this three-level unitarity condition restricts the theory of the massive vector boson need to be some spontaneously broken theory.
Sorry, what is the symmetry here? Is it some finite dimensional symmetry or infinite dimensional?
In this case?
Yeah.
This is finite dimension.
Is it some SUN or something? Or is this QCD?
Depends on the representation of boson bosons.
Yeah, there are the focus that he's in. Maybe he's coming.
Of a string.
Here, the Chidon symmetry is just a spontaneous broken symmetry.
Oh, okay. So in this case, it's in the original case, it wasn't a Higgs symmetry.
Okay. It's not manifest in the low energy, but if you go to the high energy,
what's the symmetry group? Yeah. Is it SUN or something?
You're looking at QCD,
are you?
QCD.
Yeah, this is
usual
QCD.
This is electroweak.
Ah, so yes.
Whatever is SUN of some sort,
yeah.
Right?
It's
the
standard
thing. Okay. So, which SUN symmetry?
The global symmetry of Gaussian boson.
The Gaussian boson for what symmetry?
Yeah. SU2 times U1.
Are you talking about QC or
electroweak? For example, in the usual standard model, the Gaussian boson is a doublet for the gauge representation. But it also has an SO4 symmetry.
You don't consider Higgs effect?
No, there's no Higgs.
That's the Gaussian boson, pi plus.
Sorry, but in that case, it wasn't a hidden symmetry.
Oh, sorry. You know the Lagrangian, yes. Okay. If you know the Lagrangian, it's not hidden.
I see.
But in string theory, you don't know the Lagrangian.
Okay. Yes. So this is a field theory example. So what I want to do is that constantly a thing in string theory. So we take open scattering amplitude as an example. Then we consider some fixed angle high energy limit, which is in under some variables exposed to infinity, with T over n, T over s fixed. So as Grossman showed you, this can be evaluated by the saddle point method, and the amplitude takes a very simple, has a very simple structure. And based on this structure, the Grossman argued that there appear some linear relations among scattering amplitudes. Schematically speaking, so if you calculate the scattering amplitude with these four vertex operators, this one is proportional to the another set of amplitude with another set of vertex operators where the V1 is replaced with another one to the leading order of the higher expansion. And this is huge because it's very too old order in perturbation theory, and it also discussed that it's strong enough to restrict order amplitude, namely that maybe they can be all related to the simplest tachyon amplitude. So, of course, the question we want to know is that what's behind these relations, what kind of symmetry behind that, and that it's not easy.
What was V1 prime?
V1 prime? V1 prime is the different bracket separator, different from this V1. Maybe different level bracket separator, and the later example is simply choose different polarization tensors.
So prime means that you're in the different picture. First of all, do you have a super string or?
I'm only considering the open bosonic strings.
Okay.
And V1, okay, the later example V1 is simply just the choosing different polarization tensors and next example is a bit more common. So I'm going to concrete example. So this kind of high-energy symmetry may be related to the Moon states or the normal states. And this discussion brought this. And we first fixed the LCD basis for the 4-point scattering amplitudes and some basis vectors in the LCD basis, in this case, which is K1. And T is a transverse direction, which is lying on the scattering plane. So by using this density basis, for example, physical state condition is simply that say that the polarization tensor takes some value in the transverse direction. In the high energy limit, can be characterized by the fact that a helicity momentum is vector and the longitudinal helicity vectors are both to becomes the same vectors and the limit because masses can be negligible. Based on this fact, we can demonstrate that how linear relations in the high energy limit appears from the stream scattering amplitudes. So let me take this example here. The parenthesis 2 means that this is level 2 vertex vector, this is level 0, namely tachyon. So it's a massive tachyon amplitude example. For associated with this vertex operator, this is level 2 state. So you can find several level normal states, which is a physical spurious state. In the helicity basis, can be written this way. And if you consider the high energy limit, so as we have seen, that's a T direction tends to be the L direction, which means that state which used to be not the zero norm state, but in the high energy limit, it's going to approximate to some zero norm state. There can appear some such kind of state. So this state approximates a zero norm state. Therefore, if you only look at the leading order part of the amplitude, this part decouples. So there's some cancellation happens in the leading order. The one example is this specific linear combination and taking P to the L. So you find that this linear combination takes this form, and this part afterwards doesn't really contribute to the scattering amplitude. So from this state, and the three are taken to be the tachyon vertex operators. If you calculate the amplitude, you find that the amplitude with LF polarization projection is proportional to actually 4 times this one, is equal to the TT projection to the leading order kind of expansion. So this is a more concrete example of the energy relations. So there can be much more varieties. This is one example. So
TT corresponds to transverse stresses, or what is TT?
TT is simply that this transverse projections. So TT itself is not really the physical state, but it's this projection property. So good point is that this is valid for any genus, and this is also relevant for the choice of the other vertex operators. But this is based on the state analysis, so it's difficult to see that where the dynamics comes from. And we can see that some inter-level symmetry changes the level of the vertex operators. But from this approach, it's difficult to see how this inter-level symmetry appears. So I take a bit another approach to obtain this kind of linear relations. So another approach here, I say the relation among the amplitude proposed by Moore 20 years ago. So I did that on the one side, we consider the some deformation of the vertex operators. I define a more complicated later. And this deformation, by considering the change of the contour, to move to the other part of the vertex operators, then we can establish some relation among these operation functions. And after integration, it becomes a relation among the amplitudes. So good point is that this relation gives you some exact relation among the amplitudes. And we will see that there are infinitely many relations we can construct. And some not good point is that we need to have a very discrete set of momenta to realize this symmetry, and the choice of the physical state condition is not trivial in this case. So anyway, so we use this relation to examine high-energy relations. So let me start with the deformation of vertex operators. It's defined by this bracket relation, which is simply just taking the OPE and the contour integration over another vertex operator. So one example is that this J used to deform the other operator called deformer. It's an example, massless vertex operators. The other one, that one to be deformed, for the seed operators, now it's taken to be tachyon. Then this operation simply gives you this one. So one point is that this operation is very fine only when this Q dot K is some integer value. And if this Q dot K is integer, you can explicitly write down what vertex operator you get. From this example, the vertex operator you get something like this. If Q dot K is too much positive, then the integrand is not really develops a singularity, and just you get zero. And if it's negative, so it has a higher force, so you get a higher derivative operators. And this is a new polarization tensors. It's defined through the momenta and the original polarization tensor associated with G1 here. So this example said that the deformation, the vertex operators can be taken a specific form of the polarization tensors. And the level of the vertex operator depends on your choice of this Q dot K. And actually, from this one, to realize, for example, level 2 vertex operator, you can choose a various, for example, J or B, or some combination of Q dot K. So there are infinitely many choices to realize some level vertex operator, but they take a different form. If you start with some deformed vertex operator at this position, then onto a deformation, you can move the deformation to the other vertex operators. So upon integration, this can be dug into the relation among the scattering amplitudes. In this example, these four scattering amplitudes are related to each other. If you start with some endpoint function, then there will be some m terms and distributions about n number of the endpoint functions. So to discuss the high-energy symmetry, I take the simplest example. That's the form operator, just the vectors just before, and then some seed operators. I prepared some massless vertex operators and tachyon, and the q dot k chosen to be minus 1, minus, and plus 1 for each vertex operators. Just doing that, the bracket operation, find that then this case, relation involves only two amplitudes. First one is deformed, the second one deformed. If you deform third and fourth one, it's simply zero. So it relates two scattering amplitudes. As I said, now the deformation of the vertex operator is encoded in the specific form of the polarization tensor here. So these two amplitudes are equal to each other, which is a statement by the move of the relations. And then, because of these specific choices, the momentum, we need to actually switch this of the momentum if we want to discuss the energy limit. But it's possible in the test part. And if I take this terminology, this amplitude associated with this part and that part, then so exact relation said that this relation holds as a function of the Mandelson variable SMT. So what I want to do is to consider some high energy limit of this relation and what we can see from this relation. So one thing that when we want to think about some physical amplitude, so we need to solve the physical state conditions. The simplest way to solve the physical state condition is that we start with some conformal vertex operators. And because, well, then the default vertex operator, we can prove that it's automatically a physical vertex operator. To solve this condition, we bypass a bit different some felicity basis, which is some transverse direction, which is with respect to some q associated with the deformer vertex operator. Then we can just write down the deformed vertex operator using this basis. Then we can just find some first condition state. Then just coming back to the original more physical basis. Through this process, that one gives you this state. And here, this is the standard oscillators, and these coefficients are related to the sum transformation matrix from one basis to another basis. So, which is purely kinematical things, you can explicitly write it down. In this way, what we get in this one, so this is what I want to present this example. So this is some exact relation, same as before, but now in terms of the more familiar amplitude, so that is TT or LT or TLA, it's just projection to the transverse or longitudinal direction, which I used before. And this G is some kind of energy-dependent, energy and angle-dependent matrices that depends on the specific form of the deformed polarization tensor obtained through the bracket operation and the kinematics. Then we consider some high energy expansions, so S goes to infinity with this T hat T over S fixed. Then just we expand everything in terms of S this way. Then we write down the relations and for each column S. In this procedure, we take this coefficient G and C to be the some kind of norm from the kinematics and also the graphics of the bracket operations. And using this information, the question is how to constrain the energy expansion of the amplitude. That's what I want to do. then explicitly write down the expansions for several equations we can obtain. And after the massaging, to the leading order part gets these two relations. The first one is this TT projection amplitude is 4 times the L projection amplitude, which is a non-linear detailed from the decoupling of the finite integer norm states. The other one is that this one is a massive tachyon amplitude. It's equal to the massless tachyon amplitude. So it's a linear relation from a different level of the vertex operator. And of course, we have lots of relations. So by solving them, we can also find some subleading relations. And there are many, many others. If you go to the lower powers, it gets more complicated. It's not really easy to find useful relations. So this is somehow simple one.
Is this a new result or is it known previously?
This one is okay. I would say the new results. Maybe, for example, from I don't think it's known. Well, of course, if you calculate completely, you can find that. So far, this is the simplest possible example I calculated and present. So I just make some comments to conclude my talk. So we also try to calculate some a bit more involved example that involves the level 3 state operators. For example, this is a non-linear relation before. We can try to reproduce this relation through the same procedure. But we find that some relations are missing from this procedure. Of course, to obtain this level 3 vertex operators, you can consider different choices of the J and V or something like that. So it may be related to the other amplitude. But at least from the example we considered, we cannot find. So this procedure seems to be very powerful, and it's restricted to relate the amplitude, but somehow difficult to figure out the general patterns. So the point I want to stress here that now coefficients are some of the linear relations are given by the energy-dependent coefficients, which are given by the kinematics and the deformed polarization tensors that is dictated by the bracket relations. So basically, coefficients of the linear relations are restricted by the choice of this deformation momentum Q. So the question is that how we can develop a more systematic calibration derivation or is there any other physical intuition of that? So this is final slide. So we have just did the very explicit complete calculation to see how high energy expansions are obtained. But we may want to generalize this. For example, we may want to consider the margin point amplitude and also what happened in the higher genus. And it's starting from some exact relations. We may not need to stick to the fixed angle expansion. If you want, we may consider some wedge limit, and it's some interesting results have already drawn. And finally, much more interesting question should be how to this kind of relation really related to the deformation of vertex operators or six symmetries. But these questions are still unclear, so it should be interesting to explore this one. So the questions we started with was what is the high energy symmetry, but it's still not clear. But I hope that going along this way, we can get some answer or some hint of that. So,
imply your relation is related to symmetry, especially the high energy, because you have the relation already for finite energy before taking the limit.
Yes.
So whatever symmetry exists, that should exist all energy. It looks like that. Then do you see any particular nice structure in the high energy limit?
Well, okay.
It showed the, I mean, suggestive for the existence of high symmetry just in the limit.
Well, okay. For example, the decoupling of the Neumstedt argument suggests that there appears some new symmetry, well, because you have more decoupling states mean that you have more symmetry, or something like that. So
yeah, that's right. But this Moore relation stuff, you didn't use that much.
Right. So the Moore's relation is the exact one. So it doesn't.
Somehow it seems that you have to incorporate the previous discussion about this decoupling and the Moore relations, and then try to see, combine these two and see what happens. So I wonder, what do you?
Well, Moore's relation itself is exactly relation as you said. So, well. Okay, taking the higher the limit is taking higher the limit we can discuss the relation among the amplitude on a physical basis.
I thought your polarization tensors took on the special forms only in the high energy limit.
Okay, because of the special form of the polarization tensor, so Moore's relation relates the amplitude, but it's a very, very specific way. So one of the easiest way to extract the relation among physical amplitude is taking high energy limit. Then we can just do this one, and hopefully we may learn something. But
no, but is this statement correct that these relations are supposed to hold for arbitrary energy?
Yes.
Okay, but Moore's relations is as a symmetry at the level of vertex operators. But if you want to treat the amplitude as a representation of the symmetry, it's very involved and complicated, because addressing will mix up all the kinematic variables and the polarizations.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to focus on the amplitude as a representation of symmetries, it is easier to go high energy. So the topic is to see what is the symmetry action on this amplitude as a reduced or degenerate symmetries from the Moore's relation.
But the problem is worksheet symmetries that you hope that are important are off-shell symmetries in a way, because they appear in the CFT, in the worksheet CFT,
mm-hmm.
before you impose the on-shell conditions on states. In the gauge theory example you gave at the beginning, the symmetry that appears, the gauge symmetry, which is an off-shell symmetry of the theory, something you don't see unless you have an off-shell formalism. In string theory, we don't know how to calculate off-shell scattering amplitude, so it's a little bit hard to see what you're supposed to see from the point of view of the amplitudes, right?
Why is it, the example that he drew in the beginning, the lines were
it's a gauge symmetry, right? It's not a physical symmetry in theory. What you're seeing by this. And the same thing happens with say there's a worksheet symmetry that's related with it, which seems that's what it is, right? Because of this null state relations. So that's a CFT property. It's a worksheet CFT property. But the CFT symmetry is completely broken on shell, right? Because once you impose the on-shell conditions, the worksheet theory is not a CFT. It's a CFT with some on-shell conditions on top of it that break the CFT. So it's a little bit hard to see how you're going to see that unless you know how to go off-shell.